We have one last speaker that you haven't heard before, until now, Uffe Palludan, who is director of Palludan Fremtidsforskning. So he's an independent consultant, but has earlier worked for the Copenhagen Institute for Future Studies and for the Danish Ministry of Finance and the local governmental research institute, AKF, and has worked on the future of transport and communication. And kind of also actually all questions that relate to the Danish-Swedish cross-border cooperation in Öresund. And he has written 10 books about the Öresund region. That first one was published in 1994, and he's actually living in Malmö, Sweden, but is from Aarhus, Jutland. Thank you very much for joining us today. I'm looking forward to your comments on this panel, your introductory speech. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the presentation. And thank you for getting the opportunity to come here and tell you about the experiences we have by Öresund on cross-border cooperation of different kinds of commuting and so on. In my presentation here, I will point out one conclusion, and I would like to do it already now. I heard in Jussi Jauhainen's speech that he was talking about the tunnel across Finnish Bay, and it's of course obvious to compare it to the Öresund Bridge. And I would like to say that use the experiences we have had by Öresund. I have been working on the Öresund questions for 30 years. In 1990 was the first year I wrote an article on the opportunities created by the Öresund Bridge, and I've been continuously working on this topic. I've also been working on other topics, of course, but I've done it for 30 years. And just this summer here, I used the COVID holiday, so to say, for writing a small summary and a small book. I have it here, as you can see, called, it's not a very positive title, in fact, Border Region Öresund 2020. And that's the conclusion of all of it. What we got by creating the bridge was a border. And when we're looking at the book, you could see there was a picture, and that's in fact the reason why I'm showing you the book. It's the front page of two of the other books I've been writing. And they are, the front pages are describing the situation very well on how the situation is and how the mental situation is. This here, for example, is the second edition of my first book. And what you can see is a picture of the bridge under construction. That was a symbol of hope, and the title was From Vision to Öresund Region. And it was in 1999, this second version of the book was published. For a year ago, I wrote a book because the Danish government announced it wanted to introduce border control towards Sweden, not because of COVID, but because of one bomb attack in Copenhagen, which could be tracked back to Malmö. In fact, almost nothing. Therefore, I wrote a book on the 4 years experiences with the Swedish border control. And you have it here, and you can see the closed gate at the border station towards Sweden. So what's at the platform of Hyli station. So that's what we got in 20 years. But I have, as I said, been following the development for many, many years, and I would like to see if I can sum it up. And I will not speak fast, even though I have to do it. But the first thing was to create a vision. And when I heard Jussi's speech, and he talked about that the benefits of making a tunnel has to be described, that's exactly what I have been discussing. For many, many years, until for 5 years ago, then I stopped discussing benefits because the border control destroyed the opportunities, so to say. The situation by Öresund is maybe a little bit different from the situation between Finland and Estonia and by the Finnish Bay, but it is still comparable, I think. By Öresund, the situation is that we have a concentration of population on both sides of Öresund. On the one side, we have along the Swedish Öresund coast in Malmö, Lund, Helsingborg, a population of almost 1 million inhabitants. And Greater Copenhagen has a population which is, when you're including a circle of 30 kilometers around the city center, something more than 2 million inhabitants. So it's a huge population, very nearby each other. But before the bridge was constructed, there was almost no communication between the people living in that area. And the vision was to create a region. It was to create a so-called city merge, because the travel time from the center of Copenhagen to the center of Malmö would be below 30 minutes. And around the city merge, you could expect the development of a region. That was a vision. And during the 90s, certainly when we could see the bridge under construction, as you saw on the picture, we experienced a euphoria being created on both sides of Øresund, both in Denmark and both in Scandinavia. In my first book, I described this vision as a scenario because it was a likely future, but it was not given we would get it. There was also an opportunity for, if I may say so, the opposite future, and I called it no integration. And no integration was a scenario where the opportunities was created, but they were not used, because it's basically a question on political decisions and human actings. So therefore, so it was a warning, so to say, that a bridge in itself, an open border, is not enough for being used. So there was good reasons for discussing both what was the opportunities and which kind of political decisions had to be had to follow up the decision of making the bridge. And there was many. And the reality is that already at that time we realized that the political systems in both Denmark and Sweden did not act at all. They made some concrete in Øresund, but it was very difficult to discuss integration of social systems between Stockholm and Copenhagen, integration of tax systems and so on. It was very, but some agreements was done, and there was in the light of the visions. And then when the bridge was opened for 20 years ago in July 2000, it became every day and nothing really happened. And for the first years, it was as the visions was not realized and was not followed up by political reasons which was needed. So the commuting and so on was in a small scale. Until around 2005, then something interesting happened. We was in the boom before the financial crisis, and it means that the economy of Copenhagen was booming, the labor market was overheated, and so was the housing market. So people began to buy houses more than 100 kilometers away from Copenhagen for commuting, because they couldn't offer houses in Copenhagen. And therefore, Malmö was much nearer Copenhagen than the areas to which people moved to in other parts of Denmark. So we saw a lot of Danes moving to not only Malmö, but to Scania. And at the same time, the labor market was overheated and there was unemployment in Malmö. So many people in Malmö found a job in Copenhagen. And the wages in Copenhagen was higher, so it was very affordable for them to do it. So we saw a huge rise in the commuting in the years 2006, 7, 8. And there was made forecasts on the numbers of commuters and so on, which today would have been many times higher than they are actually now. Then the financial crisis came in 2008, 9, and the consequence was that the pressure on the markets was not the same, so the migration growth stopped. And then in 2015, we got the migration crisis in Europe, where Sweden introduced border control and did it exactly as we heard it before, also at that time, without really informing the Danes before it was introduced, so it was not organized well. And the consequence was that the rail system broke completely down. It was not needed, but it happened. And one of the reasons why it happened was that the different players, the Swedish police, the Danish railways, the Danish foreign ministry and so on, did not cooperate. They did not sitting down and talk together, neither internal in the countries or across the border. What should have been done was to make some working groups with the different organizations, because it was no one's interests that the traffic system broke down. The consequence was exactly as we heard it before, that the travel time from Copenhagen to Malmö, it was only that direction, from Copenhagen to Malmö rose, if you wanted to take the train, from 35 minutes with in between 30 and almost 60 minutes as the rise. So it's two or three doubled. It was a disaster for the people who was depending on traveling every day. And of course, the number of commuters fell. Some of them, of course, began to commute by car instead of, but that's what happened. And even then, after 2 years, the refugee crisis was solved, and there was no really reason for having Swedish border control anymore. But when you first have something like a border control, it is extremely difficult to take it away. So when we had the terror attack in Stockholm, and there was working done on changing the border control so it could take place in trains in between Copenhagen and Malmö and not at the border station. The first political announcement as a consequence of the terror attack, which was only one crazy guy who drove a truck through the pedestrian street, was to make full border control by Öresund again. So this flexible solution of border control was dropped, and we have never seen it. And today there are no refugee crises at all, but Sweden do still have border control. Yesterday I was controlled at the Öresund Bridge and had to show my passport. So it's really real. And then for a year ago, there was one single bomb attack in Copenhagen, which could be connected to Sweden. And immediately the Danish government announced that it was unacceptable that people could go from Malmö to Copenhagen and place a bomb, even though it's fully acceptable that people can do it from all other parts of Denmark, if I may say it in that way. But it means that the government of Denmark finds that there has to be a border. Malmö has to be treated different than other parts and parts of Denmark in relation to Copenhagen. And therefore I wrote my book, and then we got COVID, which made it even worse. And the COVID, and now I will stop the historical picture and try to draw some conclusions. And one of them we can see...
Yeah, we have to go on with the panel, so if you can quickly make a few concluding remarks, and then
My concluding remark is use these experiences on the one hand, also the descriptions of the benefits, and understand that there are big differences, for example, in the way the administrative systems are working, which is not realized by the administrative systems themselves when they're cooperating, for example, on COVID. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This was very, very interesting, and like something that there's a lot of research about this, like de-bordering and then again re-bordering of the Nordic region that you described in your talk.